would have to slow them down then.
I just want to know how the guy learned how to write his name backwards in script. On that poster up there.
Ah, yes.
Over here.
Up here.
Inside charge.
Oh, yeah.
Gosh, I don't even know.
That's funny.
I don't remember that one.
Okay. You're ready.
Whenever you're ready.
Okay. Well, this is the very start of Parker Brothers' entry into the Atari 2600 video game development business. We had a huge advantage, which is that we had rights to produce, through the Kenner division, to produce any toy or game-related spin-offs from the Star Wars films. Before Star Wars was even released, got his name, one of the legendary, Bernie Lewis, legendary executives of that toy group had given money to Lucas, I believe, and in exchange for that got this amazing deal. So we knew, everybody knew, that Star Wars was a really crucial leg up in getting noticed and having a first game. But the problem was that they were on the West Coast, they had a lot of contacts with people at Atari, they really wanted to work with Atari, where they knew that they understood the technology, had already produced games. We hadn't done anything. So far as they knew, we would just totally waste their very valuable license. So they were attempting to find a way to weasel out of their contract commitment, at least with regard to home game cartridges. So they set up a meeting, which they had the head of their computer services, Ed Catmull, who's a legendary guy, the inventor of the Z buffer, head of, prior to that, had been head of NYIT's computer graphics division, which was one of the great places in the day. So I was in awe of him. And he was coming out with a junior VP of licensing. And so we had a big dog and pony show that was designed to convince them that we knew what they were doing. And so they barely walked in. If I remember, Ed was dressed in jeans and, you know, very casually. They didn't know that he had a lot of people working for him. The very junior marketing woman was in classic dress for success. And, of course, they immediately went to her, all the marketing guys, thinking she was the decision maker. Of course, dead wrong. So after about the first 2 hours of PowerPoint, probably actually just overhead slides back there, Ed got a little bored. And he sort of began wandering around. And since I knew he's someone I could talk to a little bit, we actually had a very frank discussion. And I told him, well, we've got, like, I don't know, maybe three people. We're most of the way through understanding, you know, through the reverse engineering of this thing, but we don't actually know what we're doing deeply, but we're confident by the time we really have to deliver the games, we'll have something reasonable. And it was actually very hard to talk to this guy who was used to working on very high-performance, cutting-edge, large computer systems. It was very hard to even find a common language, even though we were both computer people. But in the end, I think my earnestness probably assuaged some of it. In the meantime, though, the marketing guys had decided that what they really had to do was show that we actually had a lot of programmers there ready and working with the Atari. So, and of course they didn't have enough software people at that point to understand what they really looked like. So they drafted a bunch of people off the assembly line at the Salem factory and had them put on white coats. Now we had a bunch of empty cubies. We moved into a pretty much empty fourth floor at Parker Brothers. And I had these guys, they were ordered to sit and look at these terminals we had moved into, which weren't connected to anything. And under no circumstances, don't say a word at all, these guys going through. And so the idea was there's supposed to be this tour showing all of these game people there in their white coats, seated in front of these BT-100s and whatever they were. And it was absolutely laughable. Perhaps it impressed the young licensing person, but you know, I think Catmull probably could hardly keep from laughing out loud. But in the end, you know, it was great. The marketing guys sort of connected on their level, and the technical people connected on their level, and you know, they did not pull the contract. Otherwise, we probably never would have gotten into the business. So that's our visit from Lucasfilm.
That's good.
That's a great story.
Anyway.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Yep. I love the white coats. I think some of them had clip boys too, I'm not sure. Oh no, it was just, you know, they didn't even tell me until I saw these people moving in. I was just astounded that they thought this would work.
Whose collection of stuff is this?
That's probably
yours, right?
Yeah. This is your collection?
Between us.
Well, somebody has to give you a strawberry shortcake.
Me?
You guys must know Ken Lyle, right?
Donna's the one who did that.
Yeah.
You probably would.
Remember, no, that was the Doom film. Doom Dog. No one really wanted to work on that. And she was sort of like the new person on the
He's not with that.
No, he's wound up at Namco.
Did he end up at Namco?
He just called me.
We saw him at E3.
Yeah,
and, I thought she was talking here.
Yeah, she was supposed to work there. Or I guess there was some schedule.
He was looking. Yeah, he had left. He hadn't been with Namco. I know that. He would have told us.
Yeah, he just kind of.
First time I was curious about.
I did a little bit of work for him. So doing more cell phone stuff.
Yeah,
he found me through.
Well, so doing the compilation stuff.
Was it for Activision?
Yeah, he went to Activision.
What games now besides Reactor?
I guess. The only thing that I got to have was,
Walker was for Activision.
Yeah, it almost got out. It was
so stupid and so insipid.
2 months
before the office
or whatever. I was about 18.
One way you sort of, I don't remember how it works, but it just kind of flew around and around.
You know, we're talking Walker and what was that one, Kababa?
Yeah.
Kababa was done.
No, but it's
so...
So that's what I was willing to
It's not like an Activision
It's too
name.
Stupid.
You know,
yeah.
I always thought that was odd. Like,
yeah. You know, we were different.
Right. The names all their games. I mean, he was blocked.
Ice hockey or.
Yeah, right.
Stanford. But we were a little more abstract.
Yeah. That's right. Any other titles that.
Well, you know, the title I wanted to do with Parker was.
He's looked at some of these old games.
They had a
see through the Liberty graphics.
Their idea was to
and understand what's worth playing and what's not.
I did a scene from Moonraker, like a 3D chase.
Well, I mean, usually there was just like, one or two players.
Matter space.
But they had
they wanted to have one guy running around picking up pieces of things. So I started that before Reactor, worked on it about 3 weeks, and found out it was a dead end to try to do it in the original Parker.
Really?
And that's one to Activision.
Wow.
So. Yeah, so I didn't get anything published in Activision. I guess, the whole design group didn't.
Yeah.
5 months. Didn't have anything published. Frank's and I were the closest. Rex was done.
Mm-hmm. Well, Reactor is still an awesome game.
Yeah.
I was down here playing it before, and I played that game when it came out.
Yeah.
And I was never exposed to the arcade game until, the evolution of emulators came out. So I started to play the main version of it. I'm like, I actually like this version of the game better.
the
lot of things were knocked down. Yeah, a lot of things were knocked down, but it's just a simpler.
It's easier to play with the joystick.
Yeah. You don't have to mess around with that trackball. Yeah.
This game actually ideally matched my education because I had this physics professor that simplified everything to the bare minimum. So I figured out ways to do this what would have been complicated math without having to use the processor hardly. I was the only guy who wrapped Reactor at the arcade game a few times.
The only thing I could find in the game that seemed like it was missing from the arcade was the, because you can only use a button for one thing, so yours is the decoy.
Yeah.
In the arcade, the button, or the one of the buttons was to like, sort of like,
it charged,
put like a force around yourself, so it can sort of knock them around.
Yeah, pulse or whatever, yeah.
Noticing that this is all a bunch of boops and so forth, and the Frogger actually had much better sounds. And one of the things that nobody's mentioned, because I guess Dawn's not going to be here, but she was one of the people who was heavily involved in using this big, expensive thing called a synclavier.
We did buy one.
Yes.
But I thought the actual composer... Do you remember the guy? There was a guy in Chicago who had, like, two synclaviers. Again, that's something I tried to put in my budget, but it wasn't bought while I was there. But he actually composed the music, I thought, for Strawberry Shortcake. Which is what persuaded us the synclavier was a good thing to have, right?
I don't know that Dawn would know the history of the music from Strawberry Shortcake, but the synclavier was used for essentially dismantling music from arcade games and then recreating it with the limited hardware that was available on the different systems. So they actually had modeled in software the sound system that was available in the different target platforms. And as a result, that's why Qbert has sounds that are very close to the original arcade game because they've been synthetically regenerated for use on the hardware that was available.
That's it.
Which somebody had mentioned earlier that there was a $1 million machine that was used really just to create
Well, it was like 50,000.
Yeah, it was 50,000, which in those days was lots of money.
Yeah. It was very unusual to have a synthesizer that had things like hard drives, and I mean, it was a mini computer system with a lot of special boards in it.
It was meant for manipulation of music rather than just playing in music.
Right.
So that if somebody mentioned, you know, expensive equipment for music, that was it. It was called a synclavier.
Do you have any idea how to spell that?
S-Y-N-C-A-L-A-V-I-E-R.
Say that again?
S-Y-N-C-A-L-V-I-E-R. You know, clavier is German for keyboard. So it's a synthetic.
C-I-L-V-I-E-R?
C-L-A-V-I-E-R.
Clavier.
Okay. In French, it would be clavier. But, they were made in White River? Junction of Lamont.
Yeah, that sounds familiar. Yeah. Yeah, I remember looking through their manuals at great length. I mean, very envious. Some people were talking about buying one for themselves, right? I don't think anyone quite got that crazy.
And of course, I couldn't tell you where the equipment was. I mean, when the end finally came at Parker, Don Niffitt was the only one left. And having built the department up from nothing, he was the one who was standing there trying to sell equipment to anybody who would come and buy it.
Is that right?
I have no idea where the synclavier went. I know where some of the logic analyzers went.
Actually, yes, I heard something. Things went to surprising places. But I'm just as we talk about that, I'm thinking about John Emerson, you know, who ended up heading the Kurzweil Music. And I wonder if his exposure. He is someone who we haven't even talked about.
Yeah.
He was one of our Parker Game Group, and he, you know, the Kurzweil keyboard for a while was absolutely the best, you know, piano synthesizer around. I suspect that probably had something. He sort of knew what you could do, with the synthesizer. But we had a lot of people who were pretty musically involved. That was one of the things we looked for: people who could read music, could maybe compose it, or could play an instrument. Everybody didn't do everything, but we wanted people to do some of those things. So, yeah.
Anyone want to tell the Zelda story on camera?
I'll say a little bit, but you take over.
Yeah, I mean, fill in what you can remember. That's okay.
Blur him out.
Why don't you take the seat? Okay. You can get on.
I mean, I know the original concepts, but I think you were there as it got much further
involved. I certainly was there.
Right. So people were concerned about a more efficient and compelling way of distributing game content. At this point on the Atari 2600, which people pointed out, there were now more of them than toasters in American households, at some point. And cartridges had their problems, and piracy was one thing that was beginning to appear that people were very concerned about. There were a lot of game shops actually had cloning machines where they'd make copies, and certainly there were extra shifts everybody knew running the Far East when they manufactured these things. So that was one of the concerns. The other thing was simply to have something where you didn't have to spend the money on the bottom of the plastic. And Parker Brothers was interested in also being a channel, a distributor, a publisher, as opposed to just also an originator, which is sort of what they were most comfortable doing. So the idea, after we looked at a number of ways of distributing these things, as I say, we looked at like side telephone distribution. We actually did some very funny stuff at incredibly primitive optical discs. Do you know about this? Parker had the highest resolution printing facility in the country, better than the U.S. Mint at that point. We actually figured we could fit 32K using regular printing on paper with plastic. Amazingly enough, so we had a little, like a toy phonograph thing. But anyway, we abandoned that, all of these other things. And we finally settled on the use of satellite distribution, which would then go into a cable head end. For the bandwidth to distribute the data relatively quickly, there's a lot of bandwidth in video, so at least as I recall, we were going to just be using a few lines out of the vertical interval, like maybe four lines worth, which would, I forget what the data rate was, but it was such that you could download a game in a few seconds to the Atari game. And there was also, part of the plan was also supposed to be some really heavy-duty encryption to make sure that people couldn't do replay attacks, for example. You couldn't download and just capture the data and send it to a machine again, because there was like a real-time component to it. This company, DCC, NACOM, and Burlington, that did government satellite encryption and so on, was actually consultants on the business, at least at one point. I don't know if they actually completed any of the work. So the idea was you'd be able to get, you'd pay a subscription, maybe $10 a month, and have this adapter, which is sort of plug into your Atari via universal cartridge, long as you kept your subscription up, you get several new games a month. But there were some problems. One had to do with a screwed up consulting agreement with a consultant who was inadvertently given equal ownership in the project because he was handed the standard contract given to a game inventor as opposed to someone who's just working as a consultant, and the legal counsel didn't bother checking that. So that was about the time that I left Parker Brothers, that was a big fly in the ointment. So I don't know. At that time, it seemed like that was a fatal problem, but I don't know what happened after that. But Steve, it sounds like you carried a lot through it.
Yeah, I was the system engineer for the head end half of the system. Which was such a rack full of computer boards, some of which had a slot to plug in a standard 2600 cartridge. And the hardware and the firmware that went with it would then read and serialize the data out of all these standard cartridges and produce a serial data stream which would be encoded into a TV channel. The TV channel would be sent through an uplink to a satellite transponder. The satellite transponder would send down to a cable head end, and the cable head end would then distribute it as if it were, you know, I don't know whether it was a whole channel or part of a channel. Jim has added the idea it may have been embedded in another channel, and at this point I don't remember. But I think it was supposed to carry between 10 and 20 games with a download of less than 10 seconds per game. They were all interleaved so that you wouldn't have any noticeable download time. The consumer end of it was a special cartridge that was meant to sell for about $60 or $70. It would plug in place of your standard cartridge, and it had a connector on it that would connect to a cable box. And the idea being that it was just another device to connect to your cable. This was at a time when typical cable head ends provided 10 or 12 channels. There wasn't a huge variety of cable feeds that there are today. So the idea of providing anything at all new or unusual was probably of a great deal of interest to the cable suppliers. And anyhow, we got the system to the point where I had my whole rack of boards that you could plug in a whole bunch of cartridges to. We had a cable that ran over the cubicle wall to the cubicle for Mylon Merhar, who was the hardware engineer for the consumer and cartridge. And Ray Miller had written a menu that would run on that firmware. And we could download games. And we had the important elements of the system up and running. The remainder of it, things like the uplink to the satellite, would have just been off-the-shelf commercial equipment. And the receiving end and any cable installation would have been the responsibility of the cable folks. So most of what we needed was all there. What was really needed was some drive behind it. And my understanding, at least as it was fed to me, of why the project was ultimately killed, was the belief that Atari, which was owned by Warner Brothers, who in turn were a partial owner of Warner MX Cable, were of course going to do the same thing, and there was no way to compete with them. Not aware that Warner MX ever did anything of the sort, but that was at least the line that we were fed as to why the project was killed. I think a fair amount of money got spent on it. It was considered very, very secret. We weren't supposed to talk to anybody about it. And we built the important stuff, and it all worked. And there wasn't anything terribly magical there. I think the magic sauce that it needed was, in fact, that marketing drive. And as with most things at Parker Brothers, it wasn't there.
Well, it was. I think they always had trouble giving a lot of weight to internally generated ideas. And it was actually remarkable they were willing to make the investment of money and effort and so on to go as far as they did. So far as I know, that was basically a thrust of them.
Yeah, I mean, this was not a side project. We had probably four or five people on this full time for more than 6 months. I don't think it was more than that. But in an organization where most of the product, the stuff you're showing here, was stuff that was done by one person in, what, 3 or 4 months?
Right. Or other people helping. But yeah, they're usually one-person projects.
Yeah, putting four or five people on something for 6 months was a major, major investment.
Well, I think they realized this would be a big investment. They'd have to gain access to a transponder, and this is one of the things we looked into a lot, but they probably would have had to buy one.
Yeah,
I would have several channels, but you know, we're talking about back then it was like $2 to $4 million.
And that was part of the discussion, was that apparently the transponders were normally auctioned,
yep.
and that Parker was going to participate in the auction, was going to buy a transponder, and that was it. It was going to happen.
Yep. And I think in the end it was just sort of a failure of Rare, because this, realistically, they probably would have given between marketing and all the other stuff, you know, the upfront engineering is the tip of the iceberg. They probably would have had to pony up $25 to $50 million. I think they might have made it back. It's hard to tell whether it would have really survived the, you know, first great meltdown of the video game business. I honestly don't know.
Yeah, but I mean, it's hard to look back and say what would have been different. It's possible it could have at least saved the company from that meltdown by providing an independent channel of distribution that wasn't dependent on the behavior of big mass merchandisers. That, you know, even if it means you're not selling $35 cartridges, if it means you're getting $5 or $10 a month for millions of people, and you're not competing with the closeout bins,
you know,
maybe it would have made a difference. You know, without seeing what all the numbers were for revenues and everything else, hard to say, but. It's an interesting historical footnote that most of you obviously aren't aware of.
Absolutely.
Definitely the first time I've ever heard of that.
There's no question, I think the people in, you know, in engineering and gaming area, I know, were very excited about it.
Yeah.
It was something, we sort of saw it as our future,
right? Yeah.
In a significant way. Because people knew that the cartridge system, everybody was preparing for the cycle of inexperienced buyers filling up warehouses with games that were of questionable quality, and, you know, it's a well-known boom-bust cycle, because people who are competent buyers get promoted out of that position, unfortunately. And so it's the companies that have gone through these busts. I arrived at Parker Brothers just as the handheld game bust happened, so I got to see the tail end of one of these. It's very educational. And the Parker had probably gone through 20 busts like that over the years, so they, you know, their knowledge was very deep. But who knows? It's definitely an interesting project, though.
Yeah. So this is where everybody is.
Yeah.
Let me change gears for a second, if you don't mind. Did you guys go to pretty much all the CES shows of the day?
No,
did you attend them?
No, I don't
recall ever going on a business trip on Parker's.
Really?
Yeah, I don't think I ever went anywhere.
I used to go occasionally.
Activision did. I mean, that was Activision's thing.
Somebody was there for Parker Brothers. And a lot of these, paper.
Yeah,
that would have been marketing people.
Were there, you know, marketing people again.
Well, I mean, I would normally go. Part of it is there was some deal making there. I mean, not selling cartridges, but they were trying to hook up with consultants. And there were also some engineering people, because they'd have like a wall of monitors. And somebody would have to hook it all up and make it work. And they actually also needed guys just to keep an eye on the prototype cartridges, because they had a way of disappearing, as you probably know, which is very disturbing. There were places like, was it Coleco? One of these guys had this big black wall booth where they wouldn't let anybody in unless you were pre-qualified. We didn't do that. I mean, sometimes it was really sort of like a Nazi organization. Yeah. The guys, they were very, very concerned about the security. Not letting, you know, and then it was true. Often if you just a glimpse at a game, you could understand the theme. And if you're really quick, you might be able to go back and do a knockoff before the actual game appeared. I would normally go to CES, but that was probably because I was, to some extent, concerned with talking to consultants and so on. It was almost all sales and marketing.
I was just curious about the atmosphere and the way you perceived the atmosphere, and, you know, especially as the years went by, you know, did you see, you know, competitors pop up from unlikely places, and they had booths right across from you. And, you know, when we look back at the history of it, it seems odd that companies like, you know, U.S. Games, who were associated with Quaker Oats, time around Chuck
Games,
and Free Arena put that game out for the Chuck Wagon product. It just seemed crazy that everybody was putting games out. I was just, you know, curious, since you guys were there pretty much right from the beginning, at least from the beginning of the third-party era development, like what you saw, you know, as time went by for those couple of years.
I remember getting this sort of hunted feeling when you saw guys coming from out of the woodwork, you know, and, you know, one year there might be, I don't know, 20 new games, the next there's 100, and then the next there's like 1,000, you know. It was pretty crazy, and they weren't all good. In fact, a lot were pretty, you know, people just changed a few of the graphics from an existing game. necessarily brand new. But I don't know. I mean, I think at CES, at Parker Brothers, they were probably very smug, and we didn't worry about anybody except ridiculous, honestly. We worried about, you know, Mattel Television, Activision, Atari, you know, Coleco, I guess. But you know, not very many more. Not really. I can't imagine, obviously. But all the big players, but there really weren't that many big players. Because unless you had them, you know, Parker believed in marketing muscle, that was the phrase. If you couldn't put up a multi-million dollar advertising budget, you weren't gonna, you're never gonna be big enough to bother them. That's how they felt.
It's certainly true when you go back and look at the magazines back then, and you would find a Parker ad in just about every magazine, Activision too, but you'd never find games by Apollo, it's so rare that you would find the U.S. games, or even some company like Milton Bradley, who kind of jumped in at the end there, probably following Parker's lead, right? Yep. Milton Bradley was also doing board games, and then boom, all of a sudden they're trying their hand at video.
Well, you know, they made an odd little LCD handheld sort of video game thing. I don't remember what it was called. It was very unusual that the cartridge actually contained the processor as well as the ROM.
Oh, Microvision.
That's right. And the rumor is that they paid, in fact I think it's more than a rumor, they paid for the development of the TI, 9918 graphics chip, which was the core, you know, really quite a nice processor, which was the core of the Coleco machine, but they had a failure of nerve, and they never brought the system to market. And I think that's probably true. They were working, they spent a lot of money. I don't have any inside knowledge about it, but apparently after a year or two, they just sort of backed away and they just snapped it up. You know, that's exactly the chronology. But they had their chance, and they just, you know, they weren't willing. I think they were a little more high mount maybe than Parker Brothers was.
Interesting. Yeah.
I don't think I have anything else to add here.
Thank you very much for your time.
Appreciate it.
Sure. Really.